I need a good man. Look at the ones I've had. My first beau was Jimmy. I loved him. He loved women's hats. Tony was a tough guy type. He disappeared about the same time as Uncle Velmer's glass eye. Then came Walter. Walter was stupid. This is Robbie. I have nothing to say. Then there was Tom from San Francisco. Whenever Mama saw him, she spit. Then he brought her flowers. They became pals. Tom lost his charm. My first husband was Danny. We smoked a lot of pot in college. A lot of pot. We met Jim. We all lived together in the summer of 75. A lot of pot. I ended up with a master's degree in philosophy, and Danny ended up with Jim. They threw me out, but they kept my lingerie. Bruce coached a softball team. When I think of Bruce, I think of aqua velva and big white balls. And now so do you. An illicit affair, a scandal. And I married my second husband, Bruce's brother Jared. He was a man boy. He left me for a girl woman. Me? I became a comedian.
From the Great American Music Hall in San Francisco, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Stephanie Hahn.
Isn't this great? This is so much fun. We're here at the Great American Music Hall. Did you know this used to be a whorehouse? So if you're going to the toilet and you see some ghosts, don't fret, because they're going to really make that trip worthwhile for you. You know what I mean? You're having cocktails, aren't you? Look at you. You're all having cocktails. Did you ever wonder about that? Why the hell do they call those things cocktails? Doesn't make much sense. Makes it kind of hard to order, doesn't it? Especially if you're a woman. Especially if there's some young, fine, strapping buck with sinewy thighs and a firm round buttocks on him waiting on you. Kind of adds a new glint to that request, doesn't it? Well, you have, ma'am. I'll have a cocktail. Bring me a cock. I want to suck on a cocktail all night long. How would you like that? Straight up, baby. Lord, Lord, Lord. I do believe I'll have a cigarette. I certainly hope it doesn't bother anyone. Not that I give a rat's ass if it does. You non-smokers, seriously, man. You are just the pissiest people I ever met in my entire life. You know, a shot of bourbon and a couple of smokes would straighten your ass out. You just, it's so funny. You're so demanding about your opportunity for clean airspace. Oh, come on. How can I possibly respect you? You don't have the nerve to take your own life in a horrible way, slowly and painfully, over a great number of years. Not very courageous. And you're not brave. That's the thing that kills me. You're not brave enough to actually come out and tell us to put our cigarettes out. When we're smoking in public and it's bothering you, you try your subtle threat tactics, your psychological voodoo. What is it? What do you do instead of just coming out and asking? Jump back, Jesus. That just scares the shit out of me, boy. Every time I hear that, I just want to yell, "Hey! Cough that up and get out of here. You're bugging me. I'm trying to smoke." Only people I don't respect as smokers are women who smoke light cigarettes. Only reason you do it is because some man convinced you it's worthwhile to suck twice as hard for half as much. Oh, men and blowjobs. Come on, let's talk about it. Why the hell do you fellas like these things so much? What the hell is a big deal? There's nothing in it for me. But they go together, don't they, women? They just go together. Men and blowjobs go together like fish and scales. It's nasty, it's messy, but damned if it isn't inevitable. I'm convinced that's why older men go out with younger women. 40-year-old man talked to a 20-year-old woman, 10 minutes. She'll be looking at him going, really? Everybody does it? That's good for me. Okay. You wait till you've been married a while. Your opinion changes on that little request. About the 70th time your man comes crawling to you on his belly like the stinking reptile he has become. Begging for that little treat, you're looking at him like every other married woman throughout time and space. All right, fine. But you're mowing the lawn when I'm through, you bastard. You know what you do? Ask him to kiss you on the way out. That gets him. I don't understand that. Why won't you men kiss us when we're through? It comes out of you. You might as well take a taste. You sure as hell expect us to. Oh, man, just talking about it made me thirsty. Oh, man, oh, man. You know what I was just doing today? I was actually starting to recover from the holidays. And then the day you start recovering is the day you start dreading. The next one coming up. Have you ever noticed that? 6 months of recovery, 6 months of dread, and a whole week of living hell. That's the thing, man. The only good part about the holidays is my grandmother, because she's a good one. My mother's the worst, though. God love her. And I mean that with the love of Jesus. I really do. She's something. I don't know what the matter. I'm not right, you know? No matter how old you get, you're just not right for your mother. You know what she talked me into doing? 8 years of my life, I spent being an absolute bleached blonde. This was her idea. She kept saying, bleach your hair blonde to get a man. Go ahead, bleach your hair blonde to get a man. Get a man, be blonde, get a man. Go ahead, be blonde to get a man. Middle of blondes, go ahead, be a blonde to get a man. Go ahead. Well, all women sound like baby pterodactyls when we talk too much. We know that. And I did it because she was my mother. And that is the dumbest idea I have ever heard in my life. If you are just bleaching your hair to get a man, you've got to realize that once you get him and he gets your pants off, he's going to know you're lying. And it was ugly, too. Don't give me... Some women look fine with bleach blonde hair. Go ahead, do it. More power to you. That's a wonderful thing. Everything's great. Me? No. I don't know what color it was. It was just that sort of gnarled up, white trash, cheesy, a nickel is way too expensive for this whore who deserves a sore on her lip all the time just for bleaching her hair this color blonde. Thing that irritates me the most, too, is people say, blondes have more fun, blondes have more fun. That is the biggest lie I ever heard in my life. Blondes don't have more fun. People just expect so little from them, they have all the free time in the world. I didn't go home for Christmas 2 Christmases ago. Isn't that brave and noble and just as dangerous as can be? It is. I'm never going to do that again because I want to stay in the will, pretty much. But. Boy, 2 years ago Christmas, I just said, I'm not going. Mother calls me up like she always does 2 weeks before Christmas. You going to come home for Christmas, baby? Oh, please come home for Christmas. You're our special child. If you don't come home for Christmas, it's just a happy Christmas. Oh, please, oh, please. I said, no. She said, well, that's just fine. If you don't come home for Christmas, don't you ever darken my doorstep again. I have worked my fingers to bloody stubs for you your entire life, you ungrateful little cow. I said, Mommy, try and see it my way. There's a naked man in bed with me right now. He's got a boner on him the size of a great sequoia. Now, given the choice between listening to you bitch for an entire week or getting a Yule log, which one do you think I'm going to take? I took the Yule log. Yeah, it was a Duraflame. Oh, I don't like Christmas anyway. My birthday's Christmas Eve, you know. And it's just, oh, the whole thing. Oh, the aging. Oh, God. It's different for men than it is for women, though, isn't it? Isn't it? Oh, of course it is. Oh, you men. You men. You men. You bastards have everything easy. You do. Oh, and you're so happy. Oh, good. Men do not get old. Men become distinguished. Oh, kiss my ass. It's not fair. What is the worst thing that happens to a man as he gets older? You lose your hair. Big deal. You don't have to comb it anymore. You never did in the first place. There's no big life change going on here. I prefer balding men. Why would you want to run your hands through a man's hair when you can just shove your fist right into his skull, you know? It's more intimate. And love handles. This just kills me. Why do you get so upset about getting love handles? Don't. Because by the time you got them, we need them. Believe me, you got a lazy ass in bed about then, boy. Nodding. Yes, yes. Oh, women don't share these privileges, men. We don't share them at all. We just fall the hell apart. What's the first thing that happens to a woman when she's aging? Your ass falls. You don't know about this, do you? You are really young, aren't you? Don't, oh, me. I'm gonna push you down. You don't know what it's like. See, they tell you, too, that the ass-falling thing kind of gradually happens so you don't really notice it. Oh, bullshit. It's like Pearl Harbor Day in a woman's life. It just happens, and you never forget it. You never forget the day your ass falls. I'll never forget mine. A year ago, next Thursday, 3:47 p.m. I walk out of the shower. I'm all wet and naked, you know. Good thing, got the job done. Feeling kind of cocky about that. Look at myself naked in the mirror, as women are wont to do, you know, out of vanity and fear, basically. I'm checking it out, thinking, you know, for somebody your age, it's all right. Starting to look like that keg you've been drinking, but besides that... Then some vapid form of vanity causes you to squeeze your ass together. I expected it to obey. Nay, nay, my friend. Nay, nay. It just hovered there, quivering for a second. Next thing I know, bam! 12.5 pounds of large curd cottage cheese lying at my heel. You're still young and firm. You walk down the beach in the summertime trying to pull your little swimming suit bottom down around your little firm round butt. Oh, isn't that fun? That's just fine. Good for you. Yeah, right. You hit my age, you try and gather that crap up, stick it underneath that elastic cord, whack some kid in the head. If you're over 30 and you're walking down the beach, you feel somebody tapping you on the back of your knee, chances are it's your ass. And the most hellacious part of it is you get them two half-crescent, untanned white moons under each butt flap. And you can't get those things tanned. You'd have to stick your head and your feet in the sand and put your ass straight up to God. And pray all day nobody parks a bicycle in there, you know? And on good days, you forget. You're like this. You just forget it. I'm getting dressed to come over here tonight. I totally forgot. I'm pulling up my underpants to catch a glimpse of myself in my mirror in my hotel room. I didn't know it was me. I spent 40 seconds going, well, who the hell is that ugly man with the jowls and the bad mustache creeping up there? Oh, Lord help us. Then once your ass falls, your tits have to follow. There comes a day in every single woman's life where you wake up and realize you will never walk into a bra again like it's a warm handshake from an old friend. You're gonna have to get up every single morning for the rest of your flapping life, bend over and waggle into your brassiere. You can hear your tits making cartoon noises in there. Neighbors out back yelling, sold! God, I need a man. He looks disgusted. I looked right up. God, I need a man. Tell you the truth, I'd be happy to get married. I just can't find a man. I don't know where to look for him. I can't find a decent man. Oh, creatures, yes, I find them plenty. But men, that's a different thing. My mother says, why don't you date your gynecologist? Isn't that like letting your mechanic fuck your car? Come on. And the truth is, you'd have to like the guy to date him, wouldn't you? I don't like my gynecologist. No woman likes her gynecologist if he's a man. And why are men gynecologists anyway? Somebody tell me where that starts. You know it's sick the way they treat you when you get in there. Stirrups. Stirrups. Metal stirrups. People, what year is it? Why are we still using them barbarian metal stirrups? They should have some nice down-filled pretty thing we can gently lay our legs across. But no, they got big metal stirrups. And they come at you like cowboys, you know, at noon. All you do is lay there and pray they don't draw. God, help us. And the speculum, there's a fine piece of advice, isn't it? Who invented this thing and thought it was worthwhile? Now, for those of you who do not know, a speculum is simply a double-sided shoehorn. Turns a gopher hole into the fucking Grand Canyon. I mean, how much room do they need? What's he gonna do, climb in there with a light on his helmet? And they don't realize, this is the thing the gynecologists don't know, they are so close to death, that close to death, that close. Next time you're in them stirrups and that speculum's in place, honey, you just sneeze. That thing fly out. Boom, boom. And someday I'm going to get him. I am, because he's just rude. He is just the rudest thing in the world. He wears a 3-carat diamond pinky ring all the time. All the time. I don't care how many rubber gloves you put on. I know every facet of that gym quite intimately. And I'm telling you, one of these days, I'm going to clamp down and suck that shit right off that man's hand. But before I let him go, I'm going to drag his ass around the waiting room. I'm going to make him apologize to those pregnant ladies. You say you're sorry! You bastard! Say it! Say it! And the way they talk to you, you had this conversation? This is a true story. I've talked to women about this many times, and it's the truth, the way they talk to you. Everybody gets a yeast infection once, twice a month. It's just what happens. We're women. It's pantyhose. I don't know. But you know it. They know it. It's simple. Get the stuff. Go home. That's fine. But no, they have to discuss it. And it's disgusting the way they talk to you. It's like you're some kind of menu item. Is it more like a brie or a cottage cheese? Oh, God! Take a Triscuit down there and find out for yourself, you asshole! That hurt you, didn't it? Yeah. Oh, man. I just don't get it. Why can't I find a man? Men come up to me after my shows all the time. And they're weak men. I hate weak men. Never date a man you can take. That's my rule. I get them all the time walking up to me after the shows. You know, I'd ask you out, but you intimidate me. Ah, fuck you, pussy. Thing is, they're all good in the beginning. All men are good in the beginning, aren't you? You're so good at the beginning of relationships. Yeah. You know what? You'll do anything in the world for Poontang. It's the truth. It's the way God made you. You can't help it. Lord knows there's not enough blood in the world to fill up both heads and make them function properly at the same time. This one goes empty, this one fills up. You follow it around like it's a divining rod. You're looking for a welder drill. And when you're in that state of mind, so to speak, you will do and say anything. You just will. Champagne, caviar, romance, limousine rides, moonlight drives. You will walk our ass down a beach whispering things in our ears your buddies had bust your balls for 10 years if they even knew you knew how to say it. And we're listening. And we give you what you want. Those gifts change, don't they? No more trinkets of love. All we get from you are those dirty jockey shorts with those streaks you leave behind. I don't understand that. If you can win wars, rule the world, and build a financial empire, why can't you wipe your ass? I know the rainforest is shrinking, but use two sheets for the love of God. Come on. Just want to find the right man. And you know it's sex. It's sex, it's sex, it's sex, it's just sex. It just is. It's what draws everybody together. It's why we were put here. Find a partner, propagate, and continue in a peaceful fashion. I'm willing. Truth is, no one in this room ever looked at anybody else across a room anywhere in the world and thought, oh, look, there's someone I can have intellectually stimulating conversations with for the rest of my life. Kafka, Kafka, Whitman. I just want a decent guy. I just want to find the right guy. I've been asking everybody I know that's been married 25 years or more. How do you know? They've all told me the exact same thing. It doesn't matter race, creed, color, religion. Throw that out the door. What matters in finding the right person is to find the person who's going to jungle fuck you until the day you die. You know what I'm talking about, too. Not doing the nasty, not porking, not making love, jungle fucking. That kind of thing where even after 25 years of marriage, when you get up in the morning and your knee accidentally touches his knee under the breakfast table, even after 25 years of marriage, you still look at each other and go, women in relationships like this will walk around all damn day long going, that's my monkey man. That's my jackhammer of lust. That's my stallion of passion. I'm gonna climb him like a pole and ride him like a mad dog through hell. And men in relationships like this, every time you think about your woman, you gotta go down on one knee to look at something that's not there because you got a Woody on you just thinking about that girl. Hey, Phil, how's Wanda? Good Lord, look at the carpet in the office. Yep, that's a fine old carpet. Yeah, that's a good carpet. Like that carpet. Good. And when you go home from work, ladies, you go home a little bit early and you take all the white light bulbs out of the house and put red ones in because everybody in here knows no matter how old and flappity-assed you get, everybody is a sex goddess under red lights. You put on your best lingerie, and it doesn't matter if you look like a marshmallow with rubber bands around it. You're his woman. He loves you. You make his favorite dinner. You put it on the table with the best dishes, and he comes home. He's got a nice bottle of champagne for you, a nice little trinket of love, piece of jewelry, something real nice. You look at him and say, to hell with those gifts. He looks at you and says, to hell with this dinner because the time for jungle fucking has commenced. He grabs you by the hair and slams you down on that table, and those dishes go flying in 1,000 different pieces, in 1,000 different places, and you don't care if they were your great-grandmother's dishes. She's been dead for 40 years. Fuck her. It's your turn now. He takes you by the hair, and he drags you across that kitchen linoleum, and smoke is rising from the passion in your loins as you go, and he takes you into the living room, across that carpeting, and as you go, the straddle lounge spinning, the TV's flashing, the VCR's blowing up, the shades are going up and down, up and down. You get naked from the sheer friction across that carpeting, and by the time he gets you naked to the bedroom, he's got his pants and his underpants down around his ankles, and you think he looks good that way. He throws you on the bed and you start humping and fucking and slurping and sliding and chewing and gnawing and death charming and screaming and scratching and carrying on, and you got a piece of flesh in your mouth and you don't know whose it is or what it is, and you don't give a good goddamn about now because the sheets are in the air and the mattress is out the window and the box springs is in the closet, and the next thing you know, your ass is jammed between that bed frame and that wall and your legs are splayed straight up into heaven as if to say, thank you, God, for this man. Oh, thank you, God. He's looking at you saying, take it like the bitch you are. You're looking at him saying, drive me home with that Cadillac, daddy man. And you reach that beautiful moment where your souls are tossed across the black void into the sparkling universe to dance among the stars, upwardly, downwardly, inwardly, outwardly, around and around, again and again and again. And then he looks at you at that moment, the way only a man in love looks at his woman at that moment. And you're looking at him going, whoa, whoa, whoa. And he thinks you're the most divine creature God ever made. Now that's all I'm asking for. Is that too much? Thank you so very much. God bless you. I sure appreciate it.
I need a good man. Look at the ones I've had. My first beau was Jimmy. I loved him. He loved women's hats. Tony was a tough guy type. He disappeared about the same time as Uncle Velmer's glass eye. Then came Walter. Walter was stupid. This is Robbie. I have nothing to say. Then there was Tom from San Francisco. Whenever Mama saw him, she spit. Then he brought her flowers. They became pals. Tom lost his charm. My first husband was Danny. We smoked a lot of pot in college. A lot of pot. We met Jim. We all lived together in the summer of 75. A lot of pot. I ended up with a master's degree in philosophy, and Danny ended up with Jim. They threw me out, but they kept my lingerie. Bruce coached a softball team. When I think of Bruce, I think of aqua velva and big white balls. And now so do you. An illicit affair, a scandal. And I married my second husband, Bruce's brother Jared. He was a man boy. He left me for a girl woman. Me? I became a comedian.
From the Great American Music Hall in San Francisco, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Stephanie Hahn.
is great. This is so much fun. We're here at the Great American Music Hall. Did you know this used to be a whorehouse? So if you're going to the toilet and you see some ghosts, don't fret, because they're going to really make that trip worthwhile for you. You know what I mean? You're having cocktails, aren't you? Look at you. You're all having cocktails. Did you ever wonder about that? Why the hell do they call those things cocktails? Doesn't make much sense. Makes it kind of hard to order, doesn't it? Especially if you're a woman. Especially if there's some young, fine, strapping buck with sinewy thighs and a firm round buttocks on him waiting on you. Kind of adds a new glint to that request, doesn't it? Well, you have, ma'am. I'll have a cocktail. Bring me a cocktail. I want to suck on a cocktail all night long. How would you like that? Straight up, baby. Lord, Lord, Lord. I do believe I'll have a cigarette. I certainly hope it doesn't bother anyone. Not that I give a rat's ass if it does. You non-smokers, seriously, man. You are just the pissiest people I ever met in my entire life. You know, a shot of bourbon and a couple of smokes would straighten your ass out. You just, it's so funny. You're so demanding about your opportunity for clean airspace. Oh, come on. How can I possibly respect you? You don't have the nerve to take your own life in a horrible way, slowly and painfully, over a great number of years. Not very courageous. And you're not brave. That's the thing that kills me. You're not brave enough to actually come out and tell us to put our cigarettes out. When we're smoking in public and it's bothering you, you try your subtle threat tactics, your psychological voodoo. What is it? What do you do instead of just coming out and asking? Woo, jump back, Jesus. That just scares the shit out of me, boy. Every time I hear that, I just want to yell, hey, cough that up and get out of here. You're bugging me. I'm trying to smoke. Only people I don't respect as smokers are women who smoke light cigarettes. Only reason you do it is because some man convinced you it's worthwhile to suck twice as hard for half as much. Oh, men and blowjobs. Come on, let's talk about it. Why the hell do you fellas like these things so much? What the hell is a big deal? There's nothing in it for me. But they go together, don't they, women? They just go together. Men and blowjobs go together like fish and scales. It's nasty, it's messy, but damned if it isn't inevitable. I'm convinced that's why older men go out with younger women. 40-year-old man talked to a 20-year-old woman 10 minutes. She'll be looking at him going, really? Everybody does it? That's good for me. Okay. You wait till you've been married a while. Your opinion changes on that little request. About the 70th time your man comes crawling to you on his belly like the stinking reptile he has become. Begging for that little treat, you're looking at him like every other married woman throughout time and space. All right, fine. But you're mowing the lawn when I'm through, you bastard. You know what you do? Ask him to kiss you on the way out. That gets him. I don't understand that. Why won't you men kiss us when we're through? It comes out of you. You might as well take a taste. You sure as hell expect us to. Oh, man. Just talking about it made me thirsty. Oh, Oh, man, oh, man. You know what I was just doing today? I was actually starting to recover from the holidays. And then the day you start recovering is the day you start dreading the next one coming up. Have you ever noticed that? 6 months of recovery, 6 months of dread, and a whole week of living hell. That's the thing, man. The only good part about the holidays is my grandmother, because she's a good one. My mother's the worst, though. God love her. And I mean that with the love of Jesus. I really do. She's something. I don't know what the matter. I'm not right, you know? No matter how old you get, you're just not right for your mother. You know what she talked me into doing? 8 years of my life, I spent being an absolute bleached blonde. This was her idea. She kept saying, bleach your hair blonde to get a man. Go ahead, bleach your hair blonde to get a man. Get a man, be blonde, get a man. Go ahead, be blonde to get a man. Middle of blondes. Go ahead, be blonde to get a man. Go ahead. Well, all women sound like baby pterodactyls when we talk too much. We know that. And I did it because she was my mother. And that is the dumbest idea I have ever heard in my life. If you are just bleaching your hair to get a man, you've got to realize that once you get him and he gets your pants off, he's going to know you're lying. And it was ugly, too. Don't give me... Some women look fine with bleach blonde hair. Go ahead, do it. More power to you. That's a wonderful thing. Everything's great. Me? No. I don't know what color it was. It was just that sort of gnarled up, white trash, cheesy, a nickel is way too expensive for this whore who deserves a sore on her lip all the time just for bleaching her hair this color blonde. Thing that irritates me the most, too, is people say, blondes have more fun, blondes have more fun. That is the biggest lie I ever heard in my life. Blondes don't have more fun. People just expect so little from them, they have all the free time in the world. I didn't go home for Christmas two Christmases ago. Isn't that brave and noble and just as dangerous as can be? It is. I'm never going to do that again because I want to stay in the will, pretty much. Boy, 2 years ago Christmas, I just said, I'm not going. Mother calls me up like she always does 2 weeks before Christmas. You going to come home for Christmas, baby? Oh, please come home for Christmas. You're our special child. If you don't come home for Christmas, it's just a happy Christmas. Oh, please, oh, please. I said, no. She said, well, that's just fine. If you don't come home for Christmas, don't you ever darken my doorstep again. I have worked my fingers to bloody stubs for you your entire life, you ungrateful little cow. I said, Mommy, try and see it my way. There's a naked man in bed with me right now. He's got a boner on him the size of a great sequoia. Now, given the choice between listening to you bitch for an entire week or getting a Yule log, which one do you think I'm going to take? I took the Yule log. It was a Duraflame. Oh, I don't like Christmas anyway. My birthday's Christmas Eve, you know. And it's just, the aging. Oh, God. It's different for men than it is for women, though, isn't it? Isn't it? Oh, of course it is. Oh, you men. You bastards have everything easy. You do. Oh, and you're so happy. Oh, good. Men do not get old. Men become distinguished. Oh, kiss my ass. It's not fair. What is the worst thing that happens to a man as he gets older? You lose your hair. Big deal. You don't have to comb it anymore. You never did in the first place. There's no big life change going on here. I prefer balding men. Why would you want to run your hands through a man's hair when you can just shove your fist right into his skull, you know? More intimate. And love handles, this just kills me. Why do you get so upset about getting love handles? Don't, because by the time you got them, we need them. Believe me, you got a lazy ass in bed about then, boy. Women nodding, yes. Oh, women don't share these privileges, men. We don't share them at all. We just fall the hell apart. What's the first thing that happens to a woman when she's aging? Your ass falls. You don't know about this, do you? You are really young, aren't you? Don't, oh, me. I'm going to push you down. You don't know what it's like. See, they tell you, too, that the ass-falling thing kind of gradually happens so you don't really notice it. Oh, bullshit. It's like Pearl Harbor Day in a woman's life. It just happens, and you never forget it. You never forget the day your ass falls. I'll never forget mine. A year ago, next Thursday, 3:47 p.m. I walk out of the shower, I'm all wet and naked, you know, good thing, got the job done, feeling kind of cocky about that. Look at myself naked in the mirror, as women are wont to do, you know, out of vanity and fear, basically. I'm checking it out, thinking, you know, for somebody your age, it's all right. Starting to look like that keg you've been drinking, but besides that... Then some vapid form of vanity causes you to squeeze your ass together. I expected it to obey. Nay, nay, my friend. Nay, nay. It just hovered there, quivering for a second. Next thing I know, bam! 12.5 pounds of large curd cottage cheese lying at my heel. You're still young and firm. You walk down the beach in the summertime trying to pull your little swimming suit bottom down around your little firm round butt. Oh, isn't that fun? That's just fine. Good for you. Yeah, right. You hit my age, you try and gather that crap up, stick it underneath that elastic cord, whack some kid in the head. If you're over 30 and you're walking down the beach, you feel somebody tapping you on the back of your knee, chances are it's your ass. And the most hellacious part of it is you get them two half-crescent, untanned white moons under each butt flap. And you can't get those things tanned. You'd have to stick your head and your feet in the sand and put your ass straight up to God. And pray all day nobody parks a bicycle in there, you know? And on good days, you forget. You're like this. You just forget it. I'm getting dressed to come over here tonight. I totally forgot. I'm pulling up my underpants to catch a glimpse of myself in my mirror in my hotel room. I didn't know it was me. I spent 40 seconds going, well, who the hell is that ugly man with the jowls and the bad mustache creeping up there? Oh, Lord help us. Then once your ass falls, your tits have to follow. There comes a day in every single woman's life where you wake up and realize you will never walk into a bra again like it's a warm handshake from an old friend. You're gonna have to get up every single morning for the rest of your flapping life, bend over and waggle into your brassiere. You can hear your tits making cartoon noises in there. Neighbors out back yelling, sold! Oh, Lord. Oh, God, I need a man. He looks disgusted. I looked right up. God, I need a man. Tell you the truth, I'd be happy to get married. I just can't find a man. I don't know where to look for him. I can't find a decent man. Oh, creatures, yes, I find them plenty. But men, that's a different thing. My mother says, why don't you date your gynecologist? Isn't that like letting your mechanic fuck your car? Come on. And the truth is, you'd have to like the guy to date him, wouldn't you? I don't like my gynecologist. No woman likes her gynecologist if he's a man. And why are men gynecologists anyway? Somebody tell me where that starts. You know it's sick the way they treat you when you get in there. Stirrups. Stirrups. Metal stirrups. People, what year is it? Why are we still using them barbarian metal stirrups? They should have some nice down-filled pretty thing we can gently lay our legs across. But no, they got big metal stirrups. And they come at you like cowboys, you know, at noon. All you do is lay there and pray they don't draw. God, help us. And the speculum, there's a fine piece of advice, isn't it? Who invented this thing and thought it was worthwhile? Now, for those of you who do not know, a speculum is simply a double-sided shoehorn. diaper hole into the fucking Grand Canyon. I mean, how much room do they need? What's he gonna do, climb in there with a light on his helmet? And they don't realize, this is the thing the gynecologists don't know, they are so close to death, that close to death, that close. Next time you're in them stirrups and that speculum's in place, honey, you just sneeze. That thing fly out, boom, boom. And someday I'm going to get him. I am, because he's just rude. He is just the rudest thing in the world. He wears a 3-carat diamond pinky ring all the time. All the time. I don't care how many rubber gloves you put on. I know every facet of that gym quite intimately. And I'm telling you, one of these days, I'm going to clamp down and suck that shit right off that man's hand. But before I let him go, I'm going to drag his ass around the waiting room. I'm going to make him apologize to those pregnant ladies. You say you're sorry! You bastard! Say it! Say it! And the way they talk to you, you have this conversation? This is a true story. I've talked to women about this many times, and it's the truth, the way they talk to you. Everybody gets a yeast infection once, twice a month. It's just what happens. We're women. It's pantyhose. I don't know. But you know it. They know it. It's simple. Get the stuff. Go home. That's fine. But no, they have to discuss it. And it's disgusting the way they talk to you. It's like you're some kind of menu item. Is it more like a brie or a cottage cheese? Oh, God! Take a Triscuit down there and find out for yourself, you asshole! That hurt you, didn't it? Yeah. Oh, man. I just don't get it. Why can't I find a man? Men come up to me after my shows all the time. And they're weak men. I hate weak men. Never date a man you can take. That's my rule. I get them all the time walking up to me after the shows. You know, I'd ask you out, but you intimidate me. Ah, fuck you, pussy. Thing is, they're all good in the beginning. All men are good in the beginning, aren't you? You're so good at the beginning of relationships. Yeah. You know what? You'll do anything in the world for Poontang. It's the truth. It's the way God made you. You can't help it. Lord knows there's not enough blood in the world to fill up both heads and make them function properly at the same time. This one goes empty. This one fills up. You follow it around like it's a divining rod. You're looking for a well to drill. And when you're in that state of mind, so to speak, you will do and say anything. You just will. Champagne, caviar, romance, limousine rides, moonlight drives. You will walk our ass down a beach whispering things in our ears your buddies had bust your balls for 10 years if they even knew you knew how to say it. And we're listening. And we give you what you want. Those gifts change, don't they? No more trinkets of love. All we get from you are those dirty jockey shorts with those streaks you leave behind. I don't understand that. You can win wars, rule the world, and build a financial empire. Why can't you wipe your ass? I know the rainforest is shrinking, but use 2 sheets for the love of God. Come on. You want to find the right man. And you know it's sex. It's sex, it's sex, it's sex, it's just sex. It just is. It's what draws everybody together. It's why we were put here. Find a partner, propagate, and continue in a peaceful fashion. I'm willing. Truth is, no one in this room ever looked at anybody else across a room anywhere in the world and thought, Look, there's someone I can have intellectually stimulating conversations with for the rest of my life. Kafka, Kafka, Whitman. I just want a decent guy. I just want to find the right guy. I've been asking everybody I know that's been married 25 years or more. How do you know? They've all told me the exact same thing. It doesn't matter race, creed, color, religion. Throw that out the door. What matters in finding the right person is to find the person who's gonna jungle fuck you until the day you die. You know what I'm talking about, too. Not doing the nasty, not porking, not making love, jungle fucking. That kind of thing where even after 25 years of marriage, when you get up in the morning and your knee accidentally touches his knee under the breakfast table, even after 25 years of marriage, you still look at each other and go, women in relationships like this will walk around all damn day long going, that's my monkey man. That's my jackhammer of lust. That's my stallion of passion. I'm gonna climb him like a pole and ride him like a mad dog through hell. And men in relationships like this, every time you think about your woman, you gotta go down on one knee to look at something that's not there, because you got a Woody on you just thinking about that girl. Hey, Phil, how's Wanda? Good Lord, look at the carpet in the office. Yep, that's a fine old carpet. Yeah, that's a good carpet. Like that carpet. Good. And when you go home from work, ladies, you go home a little bit early, and you take all the white light bulbs out of the house and put red ones in, because everybody in here knows, no matter how old and flappity-assed you get, everybody is a sex goddess under red lights. You put on your best lingerie, and it doesn't matter if you look like a marshmallow with rubber bands around it. You're his woman. He loves you. You make his favorite dinner. You put it out on the table with the best dishes, and he comes home. He's got a nice bottle of champagne for you, a nice little trinket of love, piece of jewelry, something real nice. You look at him and say, to hell with those gifts. He looks at you and says, to hell with this dinner, because the time for jungle fucking has commenced. He grabs you by the hair and slams you down on that table, and those dishes go flying in 1,000 different pieces, in 1,000 different places, and you don't care if they were your great-grandmother's dishes. She's been dead for 40 years. Fuck her, it's your turn now. He takes you by the hair, and he drags you across that kitchen linoleum, and smoke is rising from the passion in your loins as you go, and he takes you into the living room, across that carpeting, and as you go, the straddle lounge spinning, the TV's flashing, the VCR's blowing up, the shades are going up and down, up and down. You get naked from the sheer friction across that carpeting, and by the time he gets you naked to the bedroom, he's got his pants and his underpants down around his ankles, and you think he looks good that way. He throws you on the bed, and you start humping and fucking and slurping and sliding and chewing and gnawing and death charming and screaming and scratching and carrying on, and you got a piece of flesh in your mouth, and you don't know whose it is or what it is, and you don't give a good goddamn about now, because the sheets are in the air, and the mattress is out the window, and the box springs is in the closet, and the next thing you know, your ass is jammed between that bed frame and that wall, and your legs are splayed straight up into heaven, as if to say, thank you, God, for this man. Oh, thank you, God. Thank you. And then he's looking at you saying, take it like the bitch you are. You're looking at him saying, drive me home with that Cadillac daddy man. And you reach that beautiful moment where your souls are tossed across the black void into the sparkling universe to dance among the stars, upwardly, downwardly, inwardly, outwardly, around and around, again and again and again. And then he looks at you at that moment, the way only a man in love looks at his woman at that moment. And you're looking at him going, whoa, whoa. And he thinks you're the most divine creature God ever made. Now, that's all I'm asking for. Is that too much?